Welcome to Off the Page, the show where we talk with Colorado authors to get the story behind the story. I'm Stacy McKenzie, a librarian here at Mamie Dowd Eisenhower Public Library in Broomfield. And today we're going to be talking to John Daly, author of From a Dead Sleep. Hello, John. How are you today?
I'm great. Thank you, Stacy.
That is a deep title. So, John, before we get started, I always like to ask authors what you're doing when you're not being an author.
Well, my background is in software development. I worked full-time as a software developer for about 16 years. For the past couple of years, I've been doing a lot of IT contract work out of my house. I work for a couple of different companies, doing anything from website creation to some light programming. I've actually done some work for my publisher, BQB Publishing. I'm their social media manager, and I also do pretty much any sort of IT service they need, whether it be website maintenance or the blog work, any of that sort of thing.
And you have done some writing before mm-hmm. you got into novel fiction writing. Tell me about that.
Well, I've done a little bit. In the past few years, I've been into writing about national current topics, national mm-hmm. commentary. I write for the website of Bernie Goldberg. He's a kind of well-known journalist. He's been around for quite a while. He worked for CBS News for 30 years, and he's now a Fox News contributor. He has also written several books, including New York Times best-selling books. I've been writing for his site for about 3 years. It was kind of interesting how that came about. I've been a fan of his for some time, and what he writes about primarily is media bias, how a lot of journalists have a tendency to use their own political biases and ideological biases.
You're
in the way they
me.
Yeah, you don't believe that?
The media is biased?
I know.
I guess
alert.
Enough to write
That's
about.
That's breaking news, everybody.
Yes. Go ahead.
Oh, no. But yeah, it's a topic I've been interested in some time, and I've been a fan of his, and I used to read the columns he does on his website quite often, and I would kind of add in the little comment section down below. And one of the topics he wrote one day was the same as a topic I had written about in a local op-ed for the Greeley Tribune. That's my my local paper. And I put a link in there kind of saying, these are my thoughts, he happened to read it and was so interested and impressed by it, he actually asked if I would start writing for his website. So. Yeah, that was quite an honor. He's someone I admire quite a bit, so that was kind of an exciting thing. So I've been doing that for about 3 years. And my other weekly column is for the Greeley Tribune. I started that about 2 years ago. It's a parenting column. And I have kind of, it's actually the blog that I write for that's part of that paper is called the Greeley Moms Blog. I'm obviously not a mom.
Not
but
quite, yes.
A couple of years ago, one of the people that wrote for it put out a statement that they were looking for a dad to write one of the they have a daily column each week, and they wanted a dad to write for Tuesdays. So I kind of let them know I was interested in that, and in addition to being a work from home dad, I'm kind of a stay at home dad as well, uh-huh. even though I do work. But I'm the one who, gets my kids off to school each day and all that and makes their meals and takes care of all those things. So they kind of wanted that perspective, and I think I gave it to them.
Does it have humor in it, or is it advice-oriented?
It's got a lot of humor in it. A lot of it it's pretty laid back. It's kind of interesting, the mix between the two, because I write national commentary, which is usually from a serious viewpoint.
Uh-huh.
And then I write about being a parent and kind of the silly things and kind of the stigma that comes with being a stay-at-home dad as
yes.
opposed to, a lot of people don't think about that, but I get asked a lot of strange questions, and there's a lot of odd perceptions out there.
How fun. So you have sort of a political type of writing that you do
mm-hmm.
and then a humorous advice parenting, and now we have, dun-dun-dun, From a Dead Sleep.
Yes.
So you've been writing a lot of nonfiction articles. What made you say, hey, it's time to write this deep, dark fiction novel?
Well, it's kind of interesting because up until, I'd say, about 10 years ago, I wasn't really even much of a reader as far as pleasure reading goes. I would read the occasional biography from time to time of people that interested me, but I wasn't really into fiction at all. And it's kind of a long story what got me started on it, but I hope that's okay.
Sure.
But years ago, my wife and I used to watch this TV show on the E! Entertainment Network called The Soup. It's still on, and it's it started off as Talk Soup and changed later. It's hosted by Joel McHale, who's on the sitcom Community, and he's a pretty funny guy. But we used to enjoy that. And for people that aren't familiar with what that show is about, it basically they look at funny reality TV show clips that happen throughout the week, kind of stuff that's easy to mock, and they make jokes about it, and it's kind of a funny show. And I was watching it years ago, and they were, one of their favorite targets at that time was a man named Tim Green, and he had just started hosting kind of a revamp of the show called A Current Affair. I think years ago, Maury Povich hosted that. But the reason they showed him on that show so much was because, you know, he just was not comfortable in the role at all. He was very stiff, very comical unintentionally. And you know, he was a former NFL football player, so he's kind of this big guy, and you could kind of tell that he wasn't really comfortable in the role. So they kind of had made a lot of jokes at his expense.
Yeah.
So I had that name Tim Green in my head, and not long after that, I couldn't sleep one night, maybe 2 a.m, and I'm flipping channels, and I happened to come upon an interview with somebody interviewing Tim Green. And usually, based on what I'd seen on The Soup, he was always the interviewer. So I stopped flipping channels and kind of watched it for a while to see what, you know, they were asking him about. And he was talking about a new novel, a new mystery suspense thriller novel he had just that had just been released by him, called Exact Revenge. And during that interview, it surprised me that he was an author, just because, you know, the way I had seen him in his other element, I kind of was left with this impression that, you know, this poor guy can't string words together. And I felt bad. But no, yeah, that's what kept me watching. And it turns out he had written something like a dozen books by that point, was a New York Times bestselling author, was a lawyer, had all these different parts of his life. And it really kind of blew me away. And after the interview, I got onto my laptop computer, and I pulled up his book on Amazon.com, you know, where you can look at that little preview of books, and read the first half of the first chapter, I think. And I was blown away. I mean, this guy was such a good writer, such a great narrative voice that he had. And the next day I went out and bought that book, read it in no time. Just, I loved it. I thought it was so well written, and it really drew me in, and it really kind of got me interested in reading fiction. I read other of his books, you know, at that time, and got into other authors, and it really gave me a passion for reading. And being that I had already started some writing before then, it got me interested in trying my hand at writing a novel for the first time. And things kind of took off from there.
Well, I'm happy for Tim Green.
No, thank you. Thank you.
That he could
he's a great guy.
That after not doing so well on screen, he did well.
Oh, it seems like he has done well in every area of his life, mm-hmm. except for that brief stand.
You can't
on that
expect,
show.
You know, everything to be perfect,
right?
Have you written Tim Green and let him know that he was an inspiration?
I actually wrote him while I was writing, kind of just asked him some advice, told him, I didn't tell him the whole story about The Soup, but told him that I was inspired by his books. And he's a nice, really nice guy. I wrote back, gave me some good advice.
Oh, wonderful.
And we can probably get into this a little bit later, but during the publishing process, when I was looking for a publisher initially, I wrote him kind of asking for advice. He emailed me back in a half an hour and gave me really good advice. I believe it's what ultimately led me to getting published fairly quickly too, which was really a surprise.
Yes, we want to hear about that advice. We will save that as a teaser. Tell me what From a Dead Sleep is about.
From a Dead Sleep's the story of a man named Sean Coleman who lives in a small rural mountain town in Colorado. He's a security guard there, and he's also kind of the local screw-up. He's a bit of a drunk, a bit of a jerk. Most people that know him don't really care for him. But while he's out in the forest one day, he happens to witness the suicide of a stranger, in which the man's body then falls into a river, and it gets swept away downstream. And because there's no evidence left behind of what had happened, nobody believes Sean's story. And that includes the local law enforcement, who has kind of a history with him to begin with, so they know better than to take him at their word. So after being mocked a little bit, Sean decides that he's going to take it upon himself to investigate who this person was and why they did what they did. And in doing so, he begins to unearth a lot of secrets that people don't want out there and cause a lot of dangerous situations for people.
Let's talk about that, Sean, your main mm-hmm. character.
Yes.
It's interesting how you said he's a little bit of a mess up and he's not everybody's favorite. What an interesting main character, because we usually expect a hero. How did you decide to go with this sort of anti-hero?
I think, you know, I'd say I've heard the term anti-hero used to describe him. I'd say he's more of a reluctant hero, someone who, he's not really so much a bad guy as he is someone who's kind of their own worst enemy.
Uh-huh.
And I think he was inspired in many ways. But I've known people throughout my life who were good people, but really just kind of got in the way of themselves, made poor decisions, kind of let life pass them by. And that's kind of what I saw in Sean. And I thought it was an interesting way to go, because many of the books I've read, you know, the hero of the books, the squeaky clean, handsome person, and which is, there's nothing wrong with that, you know, that's what you usually think of when you think of a hero character. But I wanted to have someone who was really, really troubled, and as the story unfolds around him, it really kind of gives him this opportunity to step forward and bring some redemption for himself. And that's a big part of the story, is redemption.
We're kind of rooting for him in a little bit different way.
Right, right. A lot of readers I hear back don't really like him at first, and that's kind of by design. He's not really meant
good.
To be a likable person. But I think he becomes a sympathetic person the more you read into it, and you kind of get his backstory, and you kind of see what kind of made him who he is. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the readers really begin to relate with him as they get to know him more, and they start to root for him.
Aww.
As you get into the book.
I like that. That's wonderful.
Oh, thank you.
Your setting's in Colorado, and you're from Colorado. What made you decide to go with what you know?
Well, I've always heard the advice numerous places where people tell you that you should write what you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I know Colorado. I've been here since the age of one. I wasn't born here, but I grew up here. And spent a lot of time in the mountains. I used to go out camping with my family all the time. And you know, even later in life, I take my family now to go camping. I did a lot of it in college and high school. And I feel like I just love the mountains. And I know just from anybody who's gone out camping in the Colorado mountains, it's so vast. And at nighttime, there's so many sounds, and there's sort of an airiness to it sometimes,
yes.
You know. And a good portion of the book takes place at night, follows one person through the Colorado mountains in a very kind of a very stressful situation. And I thought that would be a great backdrop for where it would be. You know, I kind of wanted to write a book that would have a lot of quirky characters, not so much unrealistic characters, but people that have their own quirks. And, you know, you visit some of these old mountain towns, and you got like the old prospector guy, and you have the...
Yeah.
You know, the survivalist type people.
Uh-huh.
And that sort of thing. And I wanted to include those types of characters in the book.
So people get a little taste of Colorado if they read the book.
They do. They do. It does take place in a fictitious town, but I kind of place it around the Summit County area. And I do mention a lot of places that people will recognize, you know, Coloradoans.
Excellent. Now, besides Tim Green, do you have any other writing influences?
Sure. Well, one of my favorites is Cormac McCarthy. He's a pretty popular writer. He wrote The Road and No Country for Old Men, a few that turned into movies later on. But he's written a lot of westerns too, like The Crossing and Blood Meridian. And I like his stuff. It's funny because he's not at all like Tim Green. Tim Green's a very descriptive writer, very detailed. He really gets inside people's heads. And I feel like Cormac McCarthy, he's a different kind of writer. He doesn't use a lot of punctuation. I don't think he ever uses commas in what he writes. He's such a great storyteller, and he really gets into people's, not so much into their minds, but the dialogue that the characters have between each other, really deep and philosophical. And his stories are usually about survival, very gritty, about people kind of thrown into these really, these situations where they're really over their heads. And have to fight against some pretty deep odds to survive. Really.
Yes, dark, a little
yes.
dark. A
they
little
are dark. You know, if you're familiar
deep.
With either one of those. The Road. The Road is probably my favorite novel.
Uh-huh.
It's a post-apocalyptic story about a man and his son trying to survive. And that's having a son of my own that was around the same age mm-hmm. as the person in the book, that really drew me in. That was probably the first one of his I read, and that really turned me into a fan of his.
Yeah, really identified with it.
Yeah, yeah.
Reading different genres, sort of with, I would say, subgenres within your genre,
mm-hmm.
did that help a lot with your writing process to see the range of what you could do?
I think it did. I mean, it's if you kind of stick to one favorite author and you don't read a whole lot else, I think that kind of puts you in a box. And I think it's good to go out there and read the work of other authors who have different styles, and it kind of adds a new an element to your own writing. I think it's good to read as much as you can. I really do. I think it's to read different styles and get different takes. It kind of helps you when you're writing. You know, that's a great way to write, is to read other people's work, and it does inspire you.
So we've talked a little bit about your book and even some about other the different types of genres that are out there. Mm-hmm. Who would you say is the best audience for your book?
You know, that's kind of an interesting question, because when I first started, when I first completed my book, I had it in my mind that this would be kind of a book for men, because it's pretty kind of gritty and manly and that sort of thing. But I have found it out that I think about 3/4 of the audience have been women who have really, really enjoyed it. So it's hard for me to predict, to be honest.
What are they saying about it? Why do they like it?
I don't know if it's a big puppy dog thing they have with Sean Coleman or what.
Sure,
it's hard to say. I think it has a little something for everybody. There is a little bit of a romantic element to it as well. I think it's really just the story. And I think when I first completed it, I probably didn't appreciate that it could a wider audience would enjoy it. Mm-hmm. And I've been happy to have been proven wrong on that. I'm glad that, you know, the only audience I wouldn't suggest for it are younger kids.
Okay.
And I have had at one event, some kid came up to me, I think he was probably 12 or 13. He said, I loved your book.
Oh,
I think,
oops.
Your parents let you read that book.
But, he was an old 12.
Yeah, maybe he just looked young. I'm hoping that's the case.
Yeah,
but it's really just the demographic for it. It's hard to pin down. I think it's if someone likes mysteries and suspense, mm-hmm. and it's dark, but it's not like a gory book. It's kind of a psychological. Some characters are thrown into some pretty interesting situations where they have to make some big choices.
And you said a little romance in there too.
There is a little bit.
So there you
a little
go.
Bit.
A little something for everybody.
That's true.
John, what other advice would you give to aspiring writers?
Well, as far as, are you talking about publishing or writing?
And what did Tim Green tell you? That's what's on
well,
my
Tim
mind.
Green,
you
yeah, that was the interesting thing. He gave me a little bit of advice as far as writing. And to be honest, I don't remember what that was at the time, but the publishing was where he really helped out. Mm-hmm. And I asked him, for someone, you know, who's never had a book published, this is their first time out, what would you recommend? And he told me that as someone who doesn't have any name recognition, I don't have a whole lot. You know, I have the Bernie Goldberg site, but most people don't know who I am.
Right.
And so he said in that sort of situation, it can be as tough to get an agent as it is to write the book. And at that time, when I wrote the book, I did it over a very long time, several years. And that was because I was working to basically help keep a company from going out of business. And so I was working a lot of overtime, and it took me a while to get through the book. And so he told me that basically what he would suggest for someone like me is to basically submit my manuscript to as many publishers as there are that accept unsolicited manuscripts, independent publishers, ones that don't require an agent. Mm-hmm. And I know that worked for me. It was nice because I started sending them out, and from what I was reading, I kept thinking that it was going to take up to a year before I even started getting rejection letters from what I was reading. And I think for some people it was, but I was lucky enough, one of the independent publishers I submitted to first got back to me about 3 weeks later and said they were interested in taking it. And that blew my whole conception of what I was expecting in a good way,
in a good way.
But he was, and I let him know after I got accepted, you know, I thanked him for his help, and he's just a great guy. He doesn't write so much the mystery and suspense books anymore. He writes kind of, I would say, preteen sports books now that he's been really successful with.
That's wonderful. It's a good market for them.
Oh, he does well.
Tell me about the publisher you went with.
Sure. My publisher is BQB Publishing. They're an independent publisher out of Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
They're what's considered a hybrid publisher.
Okay.
Not many people have heard of that.
I've
I know
not
you
heard
had
of
it.
That.
Right.
Yeah.
They kind of take some, they're basically a traditional publisher that has a few elements of the self-publishing in it. And it really comes down to the author basically retains ownership, after a certain amount of time. If they decide later on they want to try a different publisher, they can. But I've been very happy with BQB. But the other part of it is they require an author investment, a little bit of money for the publication or the production costs. And then you get a larger royalty fee for each book that's sold. So that's kind of the takeoff. And I think it's mainly it's a revenue model that helps with small independent companies who are, you know, don't have the resources to put into books that others might. And so it also encourages the author to do as much marketing as they can. You know, you're getting that better royalty, so you really want to get out there and be an advocate for your book. And they put a lot of, you have a lot of say-so in the production of the book, everything from the cover down to even the font in the book. You know, what they really are good about getting you involved in it.
Oh, that's terrific.
Yeah.
So a hybrid, so you've got a little bit of the benefits of self-publishing and a little bit of a bigger house.
Right.
They know what they're doing.
Right, and I would expect, you know, I've been reading a little bit more about that. There are more of those companies coming out, and I think it's a great way for, I think it's good for authors and writers to have as many different options as possible to go with, because, you know, it's good to try different things and see what, you know, different things will work out for different authors better.
Yeah, and when you're just getting started, you don't even know what's going to work.
That's
so
right,
you want to just
right.
kind of throw it out there and
sure.
see what sticks.
Sure.
Okay, so the great news that you mentioned to me was that yes. you've gotten approved for another book?
Yes, I've actually turned in my manuscript to the publisher a few weeks ago for the next Sean Coleman thriller. It'll be the second one in the series. And I signed a contract this week with them, so that should be out in stores in about a year.
Wonderful.
Yes.
When you turn in a manuscript,
mm-hmm.
And then you get approved, so you're saying that there's a lot of, is there a lot of processing to do, a lot of editing?
There is.
What happens in that year?
At least with what BQB does is they put you, they have an editor that works with you to really kind of refine your book, get rid of the problems. They realize that, they actually specialize in first-time authors, I should have mentioned that, but they... So they kind of have it in mind that the manuscripts they get aren't going to be, in many cases, they wouldn't have gone through an editor yet. So they're going to have a little bit some trouble. And so because they specialize in first-time authors, they know that's part of the cycle where they'll put you with an editor to help you really for, you know, about 6 to 8 weeks, really go through there and correct problems and work back and forth. And it's a really neat process. I wasn't sure what to expect when I had it done with the first book, but I really enjoyed working with the editor, and I was really receptive to making it the best book possible. So when they throw suggestions, I think some writers might get a little defensive of their work, but I really wanted to make it as good as possible, and you know, I had the input, so that was great.
Listen to the professional.
Sure.
That's probably
and then you know, they go through the process of the book itself, the cover, the back, that sort of thing, and it usually takes about 9 months to a year to go through all that before they're ready. They have proofreaders go over it. There's quite a bit to it.
John, when you started this book, did you know it would be a series?
I didn't. I was actually about three chapters into the second book when I had it as a standalone. It was of the same genre, mystery suspense, had different characters. And I got about three chapters in, and I kept thinking, man, this story would actually, the one I had in mind, would really work good with the original characters. And by then, this book had been out for a while. And I was getting a lot of good feedback that people really wanted to see that were some of the characters, what happened to them at the end. And I enjoyed the characters I created in the first book. And I thought, you know, it makes too much sense not to make it the second in a series. And so it was fun kind of getting back into the minds of some of these people that I wasn't sure I was going to go back to initially, but it worked out great.
Give the people what they want.
That's right.
Is
that's
that right.
Right. and it was what I wanted too. I think it just took me a little while to realize that. Yeah.
And so that begs the question: will there be a third and a fourth?
You know what? I think there will be a third. I've been thinking about this.
Okay.
I have other ideas in my mind, maybe even different genres to get into. Being that I really just finished writing the second one a couple weeks ago, I haven't put a whole lot of thought into it, you know, if there's going to be a third one, but I think there will be. I think that people are, at least the feedback I've gotten, and the sales have done better than I was expecting too, that people are really interested in the characters and want to see what happens to them, stay with them.
People love series. They really
I've heard that. My publisher is very big on that too.
Yeah,
they like the idea of series.
Yeah. Terrific. What do you say to people who go, "Oh, you're a published author. You must be a millionaire."
I say you are correct. No, no. It's funny. People do think that. That is the perception out there. I was laughing the other day. I had a friend of mine. I had used the first name of her daughter in my new book, just kind of mentioning, you know, I just used her first name. The character's not her at all.
Uh-huh.
And her daughter, she told her daughter, and her response was, "Am I rich now?" And I'm like, "No." I'm like, "If you're not going to get rich, I'm not even getting rich off this
stuff."
No. It's funny. I think people don't realize it's really up to the author to spend a lot of hours to get out there and promote their book and do events and talk to book clubs. And it really takes time, I think, in most cases for an author to get themselves established. And, you know, I think people that kind of start writing thinking they're going to release a novel and it's going to make $1 million or something like that, you know, maybe, I don't know if many people think that, maybe, but It's usually not the case. You know, not everybody writes a 50 Shades of Grey that's going to turn into this huge thing.
And some people are okay with that.
Yeah. Oh, I definitely am. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, that's great. It's good to hear that. So you haven't quit your day job yet?
No.
Okay.
No.
Or your stay-at-home dad job?
No.
You haven't hired a nanny or anything like that?
No.
That's great. So we know that one big piece of advice we hear a lot is to go ahead and read. Mm-hmm. Read in your genre to learn about it. And then if you actually get a manuscript, send that out, and be prepared mm-hmm. for some time. John, what other advice would you give to aspiring writers?
I would say just to write whenever you can, even if it's something that's not, you know, I keep pretty busy because I write 2 weekly columns, and when I'm not doing that, I may be writing down some ideas for a book in the future, that sort of thing. But I think it's important to kind of force yourself to. I read, I believe it was an interview with Stephen King a while back, where he basically forces himself three hours a day to write. And that sounds like a good period of time, I think, if you can. Not everybody can do it, but I think that's, you really have to make yourself, even if you're not really feeling up to it, it's good to do that. And, you know, obviously you can't always do it, but I would say just to kind of have your fingers hitting the keyboard and letting the ideas pour out.
Yeah, fix it later.
Yeah,
yeah. And get it out there. So your first book you mentioned took several years to write. How did your second book timeline go?
Much easier. I've heard that a lot of authors say that, where the first book is always the hardest, and it really, really is. And I think the biggest problem I had when working on the first book was that I never really visualized it as a first draft. I always had this final draft mentality where I needed to perfect each chapter as I went along until I was done. And that really, even though a lot of it had to do with just how much time I had to work on it, but that really, I think, made the process a lot slower than it needed to be. So when I started writing my second novel, I had to kind of force myself, you know, okay, this is the first draft. You will go back, define these characters a little bit more, you know, tweak the story a little bit more, but as the thoughts are coming out of your head, get them down, keep going with it. And that took, I think it took me about 8 months. Well,
wow.
not even that. It was probably shorter than that. So it went from several years to, you know, just a few months. So it
next one will be in an afternoon,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Oh, I wish. But no, that was you learn something, you know, going through. It's kind of a grueling process at times getting through that first book, but you really learn about what works for you and what doesn't.
That's fabulous. This has been some wonderful advice. John, you have a website. What can people find out when they go to your website?
Well, it's johndailybooks.com. It mainly talks about a little bit about me, introducing me, talks about the book, also has a lot of the events that I have coming up. I've done a lot of events. I'm a big believer that when you're a new author, you really have to get out there and do as many things. So I've been all over the state doing book signings and talking to book clubs and doing things like this. Uh-huh. You know, it's I think it's good to really let people know about your book, and it's good to let people know that you're excited about your book, because if you're not excited, readers aren't going to be excited. You got to have some confidence in what you've written.
Yes.
So I have a blog that's out there too. Most of my writing these days is consumed with the two columns that I do, so I don't update the blog as much as I probably should, but there is some good stuff out there, I think, and also some advice to other authors too, or aspiring authors.
Have you updated your blog that you have another book is coming?
I have not. I actually haven't announced that to too many people. Yes. Yes, I actually have a Facebook schedule post to go out tonight to let everybody know. So yeah,
good. That'll be exciting.
Breaking news.
That's wonderful. Well, so we know what your next project is, and mm-hmm. we know there's another one. We also know that you're open to talking with just about any group. They can contact you through their website. Yeah. Thank you so much for coming and sharing From a Dead Sleep with us. It's a fascinating book. Love that it's set in Colorado. And we'll be looking for the next one very soon. Get that information out there.
I will. Thank you very much.
I'd like to thank my author today, John Daly, for being on the show. Check your local libraries for the books that we've talked about on today's show, and join us for more next time on Off the Page.